Siberian Railway last summer. So we'll why don't you explain how you'd like to proceed? We'll stop midway.
I could talk and then if people have questions within it, I don't mind.
Okay. She doesn't mind if you ask questions.
People don't, you know, and then he'll be second and he'll do the same. And then afterwards we can just sort of.
Okay. So on your questions and comments, be merciful and brief.
And I'll try to be merciful and brief too. So anyway, what happened was that I was one of the first women in the trade, electrician, and I wanted to be involved in things. So I came to the a big Women in the Trades conference in 83 in San Francisco. And they had a lot of different committees, and one of them was about Russia. And they wanted to meet the Russian women, because we said the Russian women, you know, they're strong, they're like we are now, you know, whatever. And so we want to go there. And so I volunteered to lead it, because when you lead it, it's free for you. Sort of cool. So I got 23 women, and they went with me for the first trip. Now this one was the second. I just loved it so much. I said, you know, I'm going to start taking people every year. I'm doing this. And but this was the second. This is 85. 84 was my first. 85, I stayed there 2 months. And I got, the first thing I did is, for the first month, I was with a British group, which were going to Krasnodar, which is sort of near the Black Sea, and studying for a month. And then in between that and my tour arriving in Leningrad for the next month, for October, this was August and September. And so I was there with the school, then I had 10 days of my own, then my tour arrived and I did that. So I kept a diary. And I just recently said, you know, there's so much going on with all this new Red Scare and all this, you know, McCarthyism and stuff. It would be good to tell them what it was like in the Soviet Union then, because I'm fair in this book. I tell the bad stuff too. I tell the good, the bad, whatever. What people told me, I kept track of it.
Do you speak Russian?
I did. I spoke pretty good Russian then.
Good. Thank you. That was unclear.
Сейчас забыла всё. Now I've forgotten everything, but I did speak it at the time. There's the guy. So anyway, what I want to do is I want to tell a little bit about it overall, and then I want to read out of the book. I have about five or six things to read that I think would be in some of the different places I went, which would give information to you. So basically, what was so impressive was the lack of homeless. Everybody had a place to stay. It was really cool. And I thought, well, they say that, but, you know, is it true? And it was. It was just amazing. Everywhere I went, there was no homeless. And another thing that really impressed me was I was out at night a lot. Because, like, we had things with the tour, with the people in the day. Sometimes I sort of had to go to different. I really don't like museums myself. I can get it off a book or TV. But I wanted to go to the street. I wanted to talk to people on the metro. It was okay. So I was out at night a lot of times too, and when you're walking through neighborhoods, and I had some address I was trying to find, no light. Some neighborhoods have no lights at all. Now downtown they have street lights and stuff, but some neighborhoods have. And here are these older women, bundles walking down the street, walking in the dark at night in a neighborhood. I mean, you know, we just don't do that. I said, well, at least not where I was living, we didn't. So anyway, I was really impressed by that. And people would say things like, you know, my apartment is 5 rubles a month. I mean, just hardly anything. And
to them.
And everybody had medical. And, you know, nobody. When I talked to people, they'd say, oh, some people that wanted to come to the U.S. because the streets are paved with gold would say, oh, yeah, you know, so we have medical, you know. It's like they just expect a lot of things, and they didn't realize how bad it would be if you didn't, you know. So anyway, that was my main overall feeling of the place. It was a lot of good stuff, and I want to tell a couple things here, at least I want to talk about, that show when people want to fight back or whatever, that government that doesn't care, but they didn't arrest them all for being out in the street. They actually solved the problem. You know, and I want to talk about that a little bit. So let me read just a couple things.
Yeah.
And there's some funny, this one I wanted
to read.
We're talking
about this last demonstrations. They didn't arrest the people, they solved a problem. Can you tell a little bit about what the problem
is? That just happened now?
Yeah. Is that what you're talking about?
No, I'm talking about back in the 80s.
Okay.
You know, Rick could probably answer some things too, because he knows a lot about, and Paul, about more recent. I don't know.
That's okay.
I'm
just
wondering about what is it like today?
I just realized what you said, and I needed clarification.
Oh, I get you. I get you. Okay. Well, I'm going to just read a few things out of the book to tell about this. Now, this was, I said 18 and 19. Oh, there it is. This was on August 30th, and I'm studying in Krasnodar at this time, and I'm trying to meet the people after school and go do things and so on. So I said, what a day today was, August 30th. I switched classes because I didn't like that. I had a man teacher, and I could not understand him, and he couldn't understand me. It was really hard. So I switched to this higher class, which was a woman. It was for people who knew a little more than I thought I did. And the woman was, I could talk to her. It wasn't easy, but it was at least we could, you know, we can get on. Let's put it that way. So anyway, I switched classes. My new teacher in advanced class is much easier to understand than the other one. She gave us assignments, which I finished, and I really feel I will learn with her. But the most exciting was this evening. We went on a boat trip where we were told there would be disco dancing and we would meet students. It turned out that others could get tickets for this ride as well, and the workers at the oil establishment got free tickets from their trade union for this disco dance boat trip. One of the oil workers and his girlfriend, who is an electrical engineer, found Cindy. Cindy was another American. Most people on this trip, this first one to study in Krasnodar, were British or Irish, you know. But there was a couple of Americans. This one woman, American woman sort of glommed on to me. We hung out together. I don't know why. Anyway, Cindy, very strict Christian, and got so upset at the Russians that were atheists. She just couldn't stand it. Anyway. So they, so anyway, one of the workers, oil workers and his girlfriend, who's an electrical engineer, found Cindy and myself in line for soda. We started talking as much as we could in Russian, and I'm translating for Cindy, and I'm just starting, right? Well, I got a minor at CSUS, so it isn't like I didn't know anything. And I had a person in Bright. I'm from Bright, which is very Russian. It's by Sacramento. And I took private lessons from people that knew Russian really well. So it isn't like I didn't know anything. So anyway, I could do this a little. So we started talking, and we sat together and talked for a long time, and I tried to translate for Cindy. And they were Alexander, Irina, and Sveta. Alex was a real joker, and he kept kidding around. The only thing he could say in English was, "Smile if you've had sex today." And every 10 minutes he'd say it again. So people were always laughing, you know, smiling. Anyway, but he was really nice, and he sang German songs, and we women sang Russian songs that we'd learned in our class. And later we danced, and they invited us to arenas tomorrow night. So I was just wanted to tell about that little boat trip.
What water were you on?
It was a lake in Krasnodar. This was not anything
that we know about.
That we know. Okay. I didn't even know, so I guess I didn't write it down. So I wanted to, let's see, there was some really, I think I'll talk about these two things first, and then if I have time later, I'll tell a couple of other things. But in Lake Baikal, I don't know if you guys have heard about it, but Lake Baikal in Siberia, in Irkutsk, Siberia, Lake Baikal is one of the two distilled water lakes in the world. One's in, I believe it's Tanzania. I know it's in Africa, so I think it's in Tanzania. But the Lake Baikal is the biggest. It's a smaller one. And they're that way because of, let's see, I think I might have wrote it down. I always forget the name of those little critters that make the lake perfect. Well, let's see if it comes out in what I said. We went to Lake Baikal today. It snowed lightly all the way there, a beautiful sight to see from the warmth of our bus. We walked around in a small village near the lake in the lightly falling snow. We walked by a small, beautiful church and then walked up to the beach. The village was small with single homes and fenced yards, each with gardens. Lake Baikal is amazing. It's so clean. Even from the road, you can see the rocks and sand deep in the water. They say it was getting polluted in one area about 15 years ago, but local protests turned to a national protest, insisting that the paper plant, the culprit, be closed down. Apparently, the type of paper made there was a special type needed for technical data for the space program, and they needed a vast source of distilled water for processing. Finally, an agreement was reached to put a system of filters and other cleaning processes for all effluents from the plant so the plant could stay. Part of the agreement also was that in a few years, Lake Baikal will be even further protected by creating a piping system where all the treated effluents from the plant will be piped into the Angora River, which Baikal flows into. It flows into about four or five different rivers, but that's the main one. It was also agreed to restrict building any additional factories within so many kilometers of Baikal. And to me, what happened due to the people's protest is sound democratic process. I mean, what they talked about, they said all these people got in the street and they're yelling, and did they get arrested? No. The problem got solved. So, I mean, it just, you know, people don't hear about this stuff because we tried to fight the pipeline. What good is that doing, you know? So I'm just, you know. It was, and that was in the 80s, that was the Soviet Union, that isn't today. I don't know what they're like today, anyway. So that's the main thing about that. The other one
Lake Michigan was that clean 70 years ago. We went up on the lake and stayed there for a couple of days, and I drank the water out of the lake. I was,
okay,
it was 10 years old.
Well, now this one had the little, what are they called? They're not called... There's some little things that clean water, and we have them. I can't think of the word.
You're
for
talking about organisms.
Yeah, little organisms.
I don't know what they are.
But over there, those little organisms that are in Lake Baikal that clean the water. It's the only place they exist in the whole world. I don't know what cleans the lake in Tanzania, but these little things. I want to say crab, but it's not crabs. Right. It's a little thing. I don't know. Whatever. I thought I'd have it in the book, but
right.
I forgot to do that.
Keep it rolling, babe.
What's that?
Keep going.
Okay, I'm going.
She's gone.
So anyway, this is really, to me, the same sort of type of thing. I met this guy, actually Bill Mandel, Yuri Rurikov. He gave me his name in Moscow. And Rurikov, when I talked to him, when I went to his house, his little girl in her room had all this, she was like six, I think, all this stuff to climb on and swing. She had like a playground in her room, or even bed was made out of stuff she pulled and whatever. And I said, what's that all about? And he said, oh, well, there's this guy Nikitin, and he's a special teacher, and he believes in a special way of teaching kids. And so I thought, damn, my group, when they come here in October, would probably like to meet with him. And he said, well, I'll arrange it, so he'll meet with you. And so we got it set up for him to meet at our final hotel where we were going to be in Moscow. So anyway, this is what happened. He comes, but he has a film he wants to show, which tells all about it, and they can't find a projector. And so we were explaining our dilemma to one of the hotel managers, and she said, Nikitin, isn't he the one whose special is on TV tonight? It was like miraculous, you know? And Liuda, who was our group leader, said she didn't know, but the manager said she was sure it's on tonight at 8:45. So we checked the TV schedule, and sure enough, it was almost as though we had planned it that way. Our presentation was to be 7:30, and it turned out to start at 8, and then at 8:45 the TV special started with pictures of the kids, some babies that he was working with, all the equipment and his methods, so we didn't need a projector at all. So Paula Gard was there. Now, she's an American, was living in Russia and spoke perfect English, and she helped us now and then. So she translated for him and everything for everybody that was there so they'd understand. Then we saw the thing on TV. It was such a delightful evening. Paula translated Yuri and Nikitin's presentation, we saw the TV special on his methods. We had a question-answer period, and Nikitin demonstrated his, he has unicube blocks, which is one of the methods you use to train children young, so their minds will be more logical and math will come easily to them. What was most interesting to me about his method and Nikitin himself was that to most, most of us, most Americans, the Soviet Union is thought to be centrally controlled, very rigid society where creativity is discouraged and not allowed at all. And here was a man with a method of education that involves accustoming children to extreme cold temperatures, training them with gymnastics equipment from birth, teaching them math and reading at very young ages, and the use of the unicube. All of these ideas are very different from the norm, and I'm sure are opposed by probably the vast majority of the Soviet people and their government. But Nikitin has his schools anyway, written books, struggled against any opposing opinions, and now even TV specials show his methods. That simply didn't fit my stereotype of what could happen in a closed society or a patriarchal dictatorship. And in fact, the situation is vividly contrasted in my mind with the struggle my neighbors and I had in my average American neighborhood. A daycare center teacher wanted to give our children a head start. That was when my little boy, he was 4 at the time, Anthony, was in this school. And he wanted to teach them the alphabet, some writing, and for those wanting some more advanced things, like looking at the map of the U.S. and learning the states and their capitals. You know, they were only 3 or 4 year olds, but my 4-year-old son, along with others, loved the states and capitals. He learned all the states. He didn't know what a state was or a capital, but he learned all the states and capitals at 4 years old. And the kids, some other kids did, too. And little ones were, a lot of them were printing their names as well, and so on. The vast majority of parents approved of this teacher's ideas. This is daycare. Mm-hmm. And the kids loved him, but the school director and the Board of Education decided teaching so much so early would hurt young minds. We fought over this for several months, but although so many parents were on board to keep this teacher, and it seemed like we were going to win the battle, the administration harassed him so much and lowered his working hours, so he finally was forced to quit. Right. And you know, that's the kind of thing you would think would be in the Soviet Union, not in the USA, right? You'd think we'd win. No, and the parents were, it was only a couple of parents that were not for it. The rest of them all loved it, you know. So that's, those are the two main things. I have other things, but people want to get my book, it's back there. Any questions so far? Or, I mean, I could tell some more stuff, but we probably ought to let Paul.
You know, you said there were no homeless, and that, which is pretty true in Cuba too. And also that medical care is free, right? Which is true in Cuba. What about like other? Is schooling throughout like
yeah,
university?
Schooling too, free. And the I didn't say anything about the. What are they called? The
Pioneer Palaces.
Thank you. The Pioneer Palaces, the after-school program. Every city I went in, and I've been to like over about 20 cities. I've been to more when I talk to Russians. None of them have been to as many cities. And I talk about 5 or 6 of them in here, which is the ones I went to this time.
Right.
But and they all have a Pioneer Palace. And the Pioneer Palaces are these beautiful places where kids could go after school and doesn't matter. I think they're $5, 5 rubles, they were at the time, I don't know what they are now, for people can afford it. If you can't afford it, it's free. So, and the kids learn art, they have all kinds of stuff in there. They actually go on trips, they came to the U.S. a lot. They could go, their parents couldn't. I mean, you know, that was the thing they were doing back then. But, they were beautiful places, and all the places had them. And it was a place where if both parents are working, the kids could be there, you know. And what was the other thing about education? Well, I don't know. Everywhere we went, all the schools we went to, the kids were, you know, they're sort of trained there. They all wear uniforms, and you know, they all uniform. And they all are very, very polite in the school. It's like, I don't know. I've never seen a school like that. I've never seen that. So I don't know how they do it, if they're punished or what. Didn't look like, it looks like they were happy, whatever. But that was part of, what was the other thing you said?
Well, I was just wondering if there was, you know, for people who were living there, what didn't work for them, if you knew that, or,
oh, yeah.
Because you would say,
okay.
You,
what didn't work for them was everybody had a place to live, but some people were very, for one thing, they saw a lot of American TV, which showed people in, you know, in houses and big whatever and stuff like that. Oh, I'm not speaking loud enough.
I should have a mic that can pass around.
Let me get a little closer. I understand that. Anyway, so people would complain and say, oh, well, I just live in, you have to see my room, you know, my one room. I live in a, yeah, I have shelter, but I'm in only one room, and I share this thing with three other families. There was a lot of this triangle thing, three rooms, and in the middle is the kitchen, the bathroom, and so they had to share that. And people complained about that. They were upset about that. But the one thing about those rooms, the ones I saw, they were quite big. They weren't like little rooms. They were like, you know, 20 by 15 or something. And they were furnished like rich people furnish. I mean, I don't care how poor they were. Even I saw some little shacks where people, you know, you wondered if even rain would stay out or snow. You'd go in these little shacks, and they're furnished like with fancy. I don't know why, where the people get them or how much they paid for them, but they were furnished well. But I'd tell them, you know, the people that are homeless in our country would love to have just a room if they could. So it isn't like it wasn't perfect, but that was a big complaint was that.
Thank
you. I heard from people.
So you say the homeless didn't exist there?
Everybody said they weren't, and I never saw them anywhere I went. So I did see people begging. They said people outside the church, outside almost every time you went to a church, there were some people outside, two or three women. Usually it was women. I never saw a man doing it, begging. And I asked about, what are they? They don't have a place to live, or they're homeless. No. They have a place to live. What do you mean? No, they probably have a small pension, and they need a little extra money and whatever, and they like to go there, and they just loved us coming for peace and whatever. But that's what, you know, they said.
Here we have a curb and a sidewalk ready for everyone.
No, not really.
And then I told them at one point, because I had trouble with my visa, and I had to go to this. And that was on my 10 days I was there alone. I had nobody to help me. Well, Paula helped a little, but she was, this woman from America, she's actually in the Bay Area, that lived there. And she spoke Russian really well, so she'd help people, but she was overwhelmed with people. People were always visiting her and talking to her and always have parties every night. So I didn't want to bother her. But I had to bother her at one point to try to help me with the visa, and she got me a person, and then a person sent me to this address, which I went to, and he was supposed to solve everything. And he said, no, he can't solve, he comes to the door, can't solve, it's a big building, can't solve this problem. I said, no, you've got to, because I have nowhere to go, nowhere to sleep tonight, unless I'm in Novgorod, and I have to take the train, that's my room in Novgorod tonight. And oh, well, I said, okay, and I could say all this in Russian. I knew all the vocabulary for the homeless part. So I said, if you don't do anything for me, I'm sleeping in the gutter. Right here, I'm going to be just like America, where the homeless have to sleep in the friggin' gutter. And he's sitting there, and, okay. So he finally got me an address and a name of a person so I could go and get it solved. But, I mean, I'm glad I had the vocabulary, and then nobody could help me. Yeah.
Yeah, a couple of questions, Gwen. One is, what was the status of women in the trades in the Soviet Union?
Yeah.
At that time in the 80s, there were very few women in engineering here, for example.
Yeah.
But I'd be interested to know about that in the trades. And then the other question is, what are the one or two favorite, you said you went to 20 different
Not
cities.
Not this particular time, but yes, during the
over,
80s.
Over
yeah.
the years,
okay, yeah.
What were your favorite... what was your favorite place or places?
Irkutsk in Siberia. I love that. That was wonderful. Yeah, and I really, Moscow and Leningrad were good. I don't know, I just sort of like the smaller places where you can actually walk. What I really like, you know, another place I really like was in your, what is it, Lithuania. Mm-hmm. Lithuania was just, wasn't there this trip, but was the most beautiful little town I swear I ever saw. And what they, I don't know, they're happier now, I don't know. Mm-hmm. But I wanted to tell you about the women, I forgot about that. I forgot to mention it. We went over there, and this was the first trip, and we had all tradeswomen. This isn't in this book. But in the first trip, we went to a lot of factories and stuff like that. Hi, Marilyn. And the women, we found out, none of them said, wow, you're a carpenter, you're a plumber, they said, what are you doing? You're in America. You don't need to do that. You could be home and have your children and cook. And we're saying, we got that from women. Mm-hmm. But yet I met a lot of women architects. I met women engineers. I met women doctors. They're all women, I swear. They're doctors. And it's an interesting thing, too. I'd ask them, how much are you making? And women engineers were making about 150 rubles a month. I mean, you can make it on that. You can live on that. But bus drivers were making 200. So, I mean, you know, there was
a
little...
Were they male or female?
The bus drivers I met were male. But a lot of the women were in these really good jobs, but they were making only 150 or something like that. But I don't know, it seemed to work okay. So anyway, we better give Paul a chance.
We have time, but go ahead. Yeah, I'll talk.
And then afterwards we can have more questions for both of us. Let's do it that way.
Yeah.
Oh, you want one now?
What's going on now?
Oh, I don't know.
Oh, well, I'm a woman.
Yeah.
And have been all
my life. Yes, you are.
And I've been here before. Uh-huh. I was in the Communist Party for a number of years during the Cold War and the McCarthy period, and I lived through World War II, and it was hard times here. And in the at the end of the 60s, around 68, I signed up for what was called a cultural exchange tour. Does anybody remember that?
Yeah.
Cultural exchange tour to the Soviet Union, which had just about opened up for Westerners to come. Mm-hmm. People outside the West were invited to come. So there were 40 of us on the mission, and we flew over, and we were put in touch by the people who led the tour, put in touch with people of similar interests among our group, and that would determine where we would go how we would... each individual would get a chance to talk with and speak with people over there. And we went to Moscow, Leningrad, and Kiev, mm-hmm. Ukraine. And it was a wonderful tour. I think it lasted a month, but I was totally wiped out after 3 weeks, mm-hmm. because I'm a highly sensitive person. There's been a book on that subject, the highly sensitive person. But anyway, I got really wiped out with the tour, and it was a wonderful experience, but I was really glad to get home on an airplane all the way from London, from the Soviet Union to London to New York.
Yeah,
and,
It
was...
Yeah, that part of it was...
Yeah.
Now, we took planes a lot. We took Aeroflot within the...
Yeah.
Well, anyway, let's let Paul...